Dear Professor Bartos, guests, teachers and students, on behalf of the School of Arts and Social Science, the Open University of Hong Kong, I would like to express my heartfelt thanks for Professor Bartos. Actually, I know that she has a very, very tight schedule, but she still come here to deliver a very interesting and inspiring lecture for us. I think, thank you so much for your presence and lecture. Today, we have a very interesting topic of positive neuroscience, a dialogue between scientists and practitioners. This seminar is co-organized by Hong Kong Xi'an University, the Open University of Hong Kong, as well as the Great Xi'an Christian College. My gratitude to all our partner universities and colleges. Now, I think that academic collaboration is very important. In particular, this kind of function, this kind of event, can draw different kind of research idea, agenda, and methodology. Some of our research idea may not be very mature at this stage, but I think Professor Bartos is very mature. But some of the young scholars, students, they want to develop a new research. They always have a question. They will come to me and ask, Professor Kwong, what topic can I research on? Or what final year project I should write? I think one of the very good source to have the new idea is attend seminar, attend lecture. So inter-institutional collaboration is not just for academic, it is for student, for any people who want to receive and listen to new idea. So I hope that after today's events, all of you will come to OpenU more frequently and share your research idea, and then it will be a very good venue for us to share, to invent, and to develop. I hope that all of you can enjoy this evening, and thank you for your presence. In particular, without good audience, we can never have good lecture. So, all of you deserve my very heartfelt thanks for your presence. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Kwong. And now, may we invite Dr. Lee, the co-principal investigator of this project, come on stage and say a few words. Dr. Lee, please.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is my great pleasure to welcome you to the second seminar of our IIDS Positive Neuroscience series. First of all, I would like to introduce to you my collaborators in this project, Dr. Alex Chen from Hong Kong Xi'an University. He is the principal investigator of this project. Dr. Lufena Lai from Great Xi'an Christian College. She is a co-principal investigator of this project. Dr. Raymond Chiu from Hong Kong Xi'an University. He is a co-investigator of this project. Dr. Nicholson Siu, also from Hong Kong Xi'an University. He is also a co-investigator of this project. And also Dr. Best Lam from Hong Kong Polytechnic University. She is a co-investigator of this project. I would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge and thank my dean, Professor Kwong, the Facility Management Unit, the Research Office, and the finance units for their tremendous support and assistance throughout the preparation of this seminar. And now, ladies and gentlemen, let me ask you a question. Do we have a happiness gene? Do some of us have a genetic predisposition to being happy? And how can we find it out? Our speaker today, Professor Michael Patel, is the author of a groundbreaking large-scale international study which discovered the first happiness gene. We are very honored to have her as our speaker today. She will share with us her work on the genetics of happiness. Let me pass the floor to Professor Patel. Thank you.
For inviting me. I feel very welcome over the past days, and I really enjoy to see this beautiful city and to see all you here to listen to my talk. And like Professor Kong said, it's very nice to have new research ideas, and I hope that I will be able to inspire you to develop your own ideas and also to follow these ideas. Because the beauty of science is that you have a passion for an idea and you're just starting to research it, and I will actually take you along my background, how I got inspired, and also every step I took to get some answers on is there a heritability in well-being, is there a happiness gene, and what does it mean for the society that we know all these things. I'm from the Department of Biological Psychology at the Vrije Universiteit in Amsterdam, so I have a background in psychology. And our department is specialized in combining psychology with genetics to actually explore causes of individual differences. Well, where did it actually start? I did my PhD at this department on the development of problem behavior and cognitive development in children during childhood. And the question was, why do some children develop problems and others not? And I've been working on that topic for 4 years, and I created a beautiful thesis with pictures of myself when I was younger. And when I was writing the discussion section, I actually had this sentence included. So I said 25 to 30% of the children show problem behavior. And at that point I thought, well, but 70% is doing pretty well. And we always focus on problems. But the majority of people, the majority of children are healthy and happy. So I thought, well, maybe we should learn from those children and also from those adults to help those who suffer. So I actually changed topics and started to collect data on well-being and happiness and satisfaction with life. And from that point onwards, well, we made a lot of progress in defining the heritability, but also finding genetic variants. So this is actually the background. If you look at a population, if you look at a population in Europe, but also I looked at the details of the population of Hong Kong today, between 10 and 15% of the individuals suffer from mental illness. For example, major depressive disorder. So these people are in red. They suffer a lot and we need to help them. There are a lot of people that are a bit on the edge. They don't feel well, but they also are not diagnosed with a mental illness as of yet. Well, that's one of the problems. A lot of people suffer without a diagnosis. But the majority of the people is doing well. So if you put that in a population distribution, you can see very nicely that we have this big group of people that feel well and this smaller group of people that don't feel well. Well, we can focus on this group, but if we can learn from these people, we might help those people the most, the people that are on the edge of tumbling over if we don't do anything. But before we can do something, we need to know where differences in feelings come from. Well, over the past years in science, the major investments, money, but also scientific knowledge, has been by a focus on these minorities, the smaller group of people that don't feel well. And I think we should focus on the majority. Why are you all sitting here? Why do you enjoy talks? What can we learn from you to help those who suffer? And it's very important because there has been a lot of research on the power of well-being. And we know by now that people that are happy, they are also healthier. They live longer. They function better in society, very important for society as a whole, and they enjoy stronger relationships. We don't know nothing about the direction of causation so far. So we don't know if people are healthier because they are happier or the other way around, but we at least know that it's associated. And given that happiness is something you can intervene on, it could be a good starting point to build your society. So if we do so, I think in the future that we can shift this whole population, make more people happy, with the consequence that we have less people on the edge of tumbling over, and also less people with a problem. Well, I'm not the only one who thinks that it's good to focus on well-being. All major governmental organizations around the world have well-being as their top priority at the moment. And they do a lot of good research, but so far the main focus has been on studies designed like this, comparing different groups. So for example, a big question over the years has been, are people with children happier or less happy than people without children? That's a big question for society, and people hope to find the answer by comparing these two groups of people. Well, being a mother of four lovely children, I can say, well, sometimes it makes you happy. This is during our national holiday, it's King's Day. Everybody in the Netherlands dresses up in orange, and we just walk in the streets with everybody, and it's very nice. The children also enjoy it. These are also very nice when we have this special occasion of having frozen kennels. We can ice skate on it, and as you know from the Olympics, maybe we are the best in ice skating. That's because we start really young on the ice. But people that do have children also know that there are many occasions when they don't make you happy. It's good that I found this picture online, because people never tend to take pictures of their children when they're not smiling. So I couldn't find a picture of my children not smiling, which is actually too bad. So I have to actually extend my set of photos. So the relation between happiness and well-being is very complex. Well, there has been a paper of someone in the United States, and they actually tried to disentangle this relation between well-being and parenthood, and they came up with several factors that influence this association. So, for example, there are positive things, like you have a social role, you have to take care of someone, it gives meaning in life, but there, of course, are also negative aspects. And to show the real complexity and the fact that it's hard to compare groups is when you, for example, look at sleep disturbance. In general, sleep disturbance is bad for people, and they don't like it. It also has an effect on your happiness. But we all need a different amount of sleep. So sleep disturbance is actually too general to state it as a factor for a whole group of people. Some people can do it a couple of hours of sleep, while other people need at least 8 hours. So instead of comparing groups, I think we should focus on the differences within these groups. And if we know more about the differences between people, we can develop personalized interventions and prevention programs and really help people. So first study, for example, the whole group of people without children, or the whole group of people with children, and study all the differences, starting by the genetic backgrounds. Because we are mainly different because we have a different genetic predisposition. Well, these differences between people are the result of an interplay of your genetic predisposition, so the DNA sequence you're born with, the environment and the social factors you're exposed with, what we call together the exposome. Everything you're exposed with from conception onwards till you die is your exposome. And then there's an interrelation by the influence of the exposome on the DNA, which we call the epigenome. I will get back to that later. Well, what do we know so far? This is very complex. It can go either way. The only thing that doesn't change in general is your DNA sequence. But your DNA can influence the environment you're exposed to. The environment can influence your DNA methylation, so influence the expression of your genes. And everything happens at the same time. So it's really hard to disentangle it. So we started to try to get a better insight in the genome and the relation of the genome to well-being. Well, there has been a very nice starting point of these studies, and that started with studies that are exceptional. Exceptional because they're rare, but also exceptional because they're very strong. And these are studies that are based on identical twins that have been raised apart. So they are split at birth, and then they grew up in a very different environment. And then they are brought together by coincidence, or and in this case by a study group, and they are tested on all human aspects. They're genetically identical, so every difference between these two individuals must be caused by genetic influences. This is a very famous example. They were separated at birth, and they grew up in totally different environments. They were brought together, and one of the funny things, for example, that they were both firemen. They never met, they all had similar lifestyle, they both smoked the same cigarettes, drank the same drinks, had the same job. So they actually are very much alike. Well, there are many examples. This is another very famous example of Alexander and Mia, in which one of them grew up in the United States and the other one in Norway, which is a huge difference. In the United States, children go to school when they're 3 years of age, while in Norway, they go to school when they're seven. So there's a four-year gap between the cognitive development of the children, but they are very identical. They meet when they're seven, and even the parents can't separate them anymore. They don't know who's who. There are beautiful movies online of these girls. This is a twin. This is Anaï and Samantha, and they recently did meet. They did meet via Facebook, because someone thought it was the other one that put a movie on Facebook. And then she saw herself dancing somewhere in a movie, and they got in contact, and they're an identical twin. This is another one, also a recent one, and this is a beautiful picture, because this, they met when they were older, but they were both in a scary situation, and you see their face is identical. Their reaction is identical. And this is one that's it's a triplet. A triplet that has been separated at birth. And they did meet because two of them went to the same university campus. And they didn't know, so people were waving at them and said, well, I don't know you. But then in the end, they found out they were a twin. And they invested their background, and then they found out they were an identical triplet. Well, these studies are rare, but there's a study group in Minnesota that brought together several pairs of twins that were separated at birth. And they compared how much they looked alike to other twin pairs. So identical twins that grew up together, that also share their genetic background, and dizygotic twins, so fraternal twins that share on average half of their genetic material and the same environment. Well, one of their measures was on well-being. It's pretty hard to see, but it's not in the details, it's in the bigger story. So the ones that looked most alike were the identical twins that grew up together. 100% identical, same environment, so that's what you expect. But the next group were the identical twins that grew up apart. So the genetics was even stronger than their upbringing. So nature overruled nurture. So there was the first evidence that genes play a role in well-being. Well, luckily these studies are rare. They're beautiful, and especially when they are reunited, it's beautiful to see, but of course you don't want twins to be separated. So there's also a lot of information in twin pairs that are not separated. This is a picture of twins of the Netherlands Twin Register, which is part of our department in Amsterdam. And they came to our university to discuss with us the content of the surveys we send out. They are 14 years old, and we were creating a survey, and we thought, well, we know what to ask. But then we invited them and we changed the whole survey actually after that, because we actually didn't know what was going on in the minds of 14-year-olds. And this is a group of identical twins. You can see this is an identical twin, and here is an identical twin. But there are also fraternal twins in here. So for example, this boy is the brother of this boy. And they don't look alike at all. Well, if you have big samples of identical and fraternal twins, you can use the information to estimate the heritability, so the effect of genes and the effect of the environment. Well, this is the basic biology behind twinning. This is an identical twin. They develop from one fertilized egg, and you get two identical children. Then you have the fraternal twins. That's a totally different biological system. It's two fertilized eggs, and they're actually born at the same time, but they are as dissimilar as normal brothers and sisters. Well, if they are different on anything you measure, it must be environmental. If they are different, it's environmental and genetics. So you can use that to get a hold on the heritability of well-being. Well, that's what we did. We asked these twins at 14 and 16, but also in adulthood, about their subjective happiness, about their satisfaction with their life, and about their quality of life in general, and at the moment of filling out the survey. And what you see here in this diagram is the 100% of the differences between people, and the amount of the differences that's accounted for by genetic effects in the darker color and by the environment. And overall, you can see that the genetic effect is about 40%, while 60% of the differences between people is accounted for by environmental effects. Well, nowadays in psychology, you always have to replicate your findings. They call it the replication crisis, but I think it should be common habit that other people do the same research and that you compare your results and take the results together to get a more robust estimate. So that's what we did. These are all studies from around the world that had a well-being measure in a twin sample and that published on the heritability of well-being. So the dot is their estimate of their study with the confidence interval, and you can see that there is a variation in sample size. You can also see the obvious effect that when the sample is bigger, the confidence intervals are smaller. The estimate is more reliable. And we took them all together and estimated an overall heritability. So I took all the information of the studies with a big sample size of over 50,000 twins, and then we get to an estimation of 36%. So we're pretty sure that the heritability of well-being is around 40%. The good thing is that one of my colleagues in Norway did the exact same thing at the exact same time. She had a bit of a different inclusion criteria, so she included a couple of different studies. But overall, she also has a similar diagram with the square meaning the estimate from the study and the overall estimate below, and her estimate is 40%. And our confidence intervals overlap. So there's actually no doubt anymore about the heritability of well-being. It's about 40% in these samples. It would be very interesting to expand that to other populations around the world to see if that also holds there. But by knowing that 40% of the differences between people is in their genes, we of course are very curious how to find these. There's one very important remark I have to make. Most times when I read about well-being or happiness in any book, they discuss the heritability of well-being like this. They say 40% of your happiness is in your genes, while 60% is your environment. That's not the interpretation of a heritability estimate. So this is wrong. It's 40% of the differences between people is accounted for by genetic differences and 60% by environmental differences. We don't know much about an individual. We don't know your genotype, we don't know all the genes, so we don't know your genetic predisposition. This is famous in all these books. They have these pies, and that's always very lovely, and especially this one, because they talk about genes and they talk about brain. And they separate it. I'm not sure where the genes of well-being are expressed, but I anticipate that it will be in the brain. And they talk about circumstances, and in this case, money. Well, the link between happiness and money is actually not that strong. So, and in this case, they talk about your genetic set point and intentional activities. Well, a lot of intentional activities are heritable as well. So this is also not correct. We really have to remember that the heritability means that the differences between people are accounted for by genetic differences. But where are these differences? Where are the genes that account for the differences in well-being? Well, this is the famous DNA helix, and we have been trying to look for the genetic variants for years. And while we were getting together all these samples, need to have a very large sample size. There was a new method developed, which we applied first. And it's a very elegant method. In this method, what you do is you ask a group of biologically unrelated individuals, so for example, a group like you, to rate their well-being and invite them to give you a DNA sample. And the simple question in this design, we did that for about 10,000 individuals, is to see if people that have more similar DNA also have more similar scores on well-being. If that's the case, you can say, well, a part of the differences is accounted for by DNA. So not only a twin estimate, but by real DNA material. So it looks a bit like this. You have these people, you have their DNA, and you can, of course, see how much their DNA overlaps. Because your DNA also overlaps. You don't have to be brothers and sisters to have overlapping DNA. You do the exact same thing for the well-being measure, and you can see that some people, so like for example this boy and this girl, have quite a strong overlap in their well-being measure, while this boy and this girl do not have a strong overlap. But what you expect is that these two people, C and D, have more similar DNA. And that was actually the case. And by using this method, we could explain about 10% of the variance in happiness. So we had a 40% estimate based on twin studies. And from this 40%, we could explain 10% by the current DNA arrays we are using. 30% is still missing. Well, there are many theories where the missing genetics is. It's either variants we don't measure, it's a complex interplay of different variants. But at least it provided us with evidence that we could look in the DNA for the well-being genes. So that's what we did. Besides knowing it's in your DNA, we were very interested to see if it might be on chromosome 1 or 12 or 18 or whatever, to get closer to the biology of well-being. And that was not a simple task. To run these kinds of studies, you need huge sample sizes and a lot of variables in your sample. So we ended up by searching around the world for DNA samples and well-being measures. And we ended up by getting information on about 300,000 individuals. And for all these individuals, we measured 2.2 million genetic variants. That's a lot, but nowadays we measure like 8 million to 10 million genetic variants. So we are way beyond that now. It took 181 scientists from around the world and from 145 institutions. And what did they do? They did run their analysis on their own machines with their own data and then uploaded the summary statistics to us. And we used these summary statistics in the meta-analysis to see if we could find something. And this is what we came up with. People with a background in genetics are always very happy when they see this, and I will explain why. On this axis, you have all the chromosomes. So it starts with chromosome 1 and it ends with chromosome 22. On this axis, you do have the outcome of the statistical test. And what you really like to see is that the statistical test is stronger than this dotted line. That's the magical threshold of significance. All these dots are the genetic variants. So we had 2.2 million genetic variants, and we did for every genetic variant, we tested if it was related to well-being. So this is all dots, you can't see it anymore, but it's all these dots, and as you can see, there are three locations where the dot crossed the line. So three locations where we can say, well, these variants are significantly related to well-being. A lot of people never believed that we would find these variants, so we were very happy that we could find it. But because we only found three at that point, we didn't try to interpret the findings. Because as you might know, biology is very complex. These variants together explain less than 1% of the variants between people. So we only said, well, we did find it, but we don't know what it means. So we ended up with two locations, and we thought, well, there must be more. And during that time, there were, of course, a lot of other studies, for example, looking at schizophrenia. And these studies show that if you increase sample size, you find more effects. The same holds, for example, for height. There were a lot of big studies on human height. And as soon as they increased the sample size, they did find more genetic variants. One other thing we found, which is very important, especially for what I was saying in the beginning, that we can use well-being to develop prevention and intervention for depressive symptoms or major depressive disorders, is a genetic correlation. And a genetic correlation means that you do have the genes for well-being and the genes for depression. And if this genetic correlation is zero, there is no overlap in the genes for well-being and no with the genes for depression. So then well-being would not be informative to study depression or help those who suffer. If the genetic correlation is 0.5, there is an overlap, and if the genetic correlation would be 1, there would be a perfect overlap. So then well-being is actually totally the opposite of depression. Well, what did we see? This is the table of these genetic correlations. So you here see subjective well-being and depressive symptoms. And there's a negative correlation, that's what you expect. But the negative correlation is about minus 0.8. So a lot of the genetic variants we find for well-being are also associated with depressive symptoms. Not all, there are also well-being specific genetic variants, but a lot is overlapping. So that's very informative for finding solutions to help solve major depressive disorder. There's also a strong overlap with neuroticism, but as you might know, neuroticism is part of a spectrum that leads to mental illness. And of course, there's a positive genetic correlation between well-being of depression and neuroticism. As a proof of concept, you can say, well, maybe all genes are involved in everything. We also looked at the genetic correlation between subjective well-being and human height. And as you can see, this is zero, so there's hardly any overlap between the genes for well-being and the genes for height. Well, we use this strong correlation to take the next step. Because if you combine different phenotypes that are highly related, you gain power. So we combined information on life satisfaction, positive affect, that's happiness, neuroticism and depressive symptoms, to increase the power for finding genetic variants. By that way, of course, the sample size increased. There are also a lot of new samples that are coming out. For example, the UK Biobank, which is a huge sample that can be used by everyone around the world for genetic studies, but also for other studies. And we went from 3 genetic variants to over 300. And as you can see, it's everywhere. It's scattered all over the genome. And at that point, we thought, well, maybe we could try to interpret a bit more. We were, first of all, of course, interested what the genes were that were specific for life satisfaction. So we found 103 specific variants for life satisfaction, and they are partly overlapping with the variants for positive affect. So there are happiness-specific genetic variants, life satisfaction-specific genetic variants, and genetic variants that actually influence your mood altogether, positively or negatively. Well, what did we want to know? We found that many genetic variants that we thought, well, maybe we can look at the gene expression. Where are these genes expressed? So we started with the genome, and we find all these spots on the genome that are related to well-being. And the next step was to see where are these genes expressed. You expect, of course, that would be in the brain, but which area of the brain would be involved? And you would be highly surprised if it would be somewhere else in the body, for example, in your leg. So we looked at gene expression all over the body, in the hormonal system, in the brains, that is available online to be used. And this is what we found. And most neuroscientists looked at these pictures and think it's an MRI study. A functional MRI study, but it's not. It's a gene expression picture. So this is the human brain, as you all know, and these little dots are the spots in the brain where the genes for well-being are more expressed in comparison to the other areas of the brain. So in this case, we found that there is a small part of this hippocampus called the subiculum that showed an overexpression of the well-being genes. So instead of only finding and identifying the genes, we also know a bit more about it because we know that they are overly expressed in the subiculum in the human brain. Of course, it still doesn't provide the answers to use this information directly in clinics, but it brings us closer to the biological pathways of well-being. But I think what we so far did is is nice and it can help us, but well-being is a very complex phenotype. So we first focused on hedonic well-being, as it's called. We looked at happiness, we looked at satisfaction with life, we looked at depressive symptoms. But now we actually started to also look at eudaimonic well-being. Because to feel really well, you don't only have to feel happy, you also have to feel some meaning in life, some purpose in life. And we were very curious if we could find genetic variants that explain the more eudaimonic part of well-being. Well, that's where the UK Biobank came in, because not that many studies around the world collect data on eudaimonic well-being. It's hard to collect, you need larger surveys, and it's a topic that wasn't of interest to many people for a while. But in the UK Biobank, they collected the eudaimonic measure, they asked people if they consider their life to be meaningful. One simple question, but in a very large data set. And that provided us with the opportunity to see if there are genetic variants that are related to eudaimonic well-being, and there are currently two spots on the human genome that are significantly related to meaning in life. But you can see that there are also some areas on the human genome that are not significant as of yet, but you can anticipate by given the other studies that if we are able to increase this sample size, we will probably find more spots on the human genome that are related. The big question always has been in the field of well-being, is hedonic well-being, so happiness, something different than eudaimonic well-being? And there are actually two groups of people. Some people say it's something completely different, and it's they don't know the direction of causation, but they say the end product of life or your purpose in life should always be that your life is meaningful. While others say, maybe it's actually the same thing. So we used the genetic correlation approach again to see if there's a high biological underpinning of these two, or if the biology is separate. Well, this is a very full diagram with a lot of information, but I will walk you through it. This is, above here, is the phenotypic correlation. So if you don't have genetic data, but you ask people to fill out information on meaning in life and happiness, you find a correlation of 0.5. So that's an average correlation. It's not independent, but it's also not the same thing. When we looked at the genetic correlation, so if the same set of genes is important for eudaimonic and hedonic well-being, we did find a correlation of 0.8. So there's a strong biological overlap between eudaimonic well-being and hedonic well-being. So a lot of the same genes are involved in both countries. To get a better hold on the overlap between these two, we also correlated it with all different outcomes. This is all genetic correlations. And for example, as I told you in the beginning, well-being is related to health. And what you see here is the genetic correlation between eudaimonic well-being in green and hedonic well-being in red. So hedonic well-being is happiness. Eudaimonic well-being is meaning in life. And you see that there is a pretty strong genetic correlation with general health. So there are genes that are important for your physical health as well as your mental health. So that's a strong finding. And you also see that there is a strong relation. This is friendship satisfaction and family satisfaction. That's all related. The funny thing is to see the bit lower correlation with financial.